It's Google. In order to tweet away, we will be answering tweets from Jimmy, who's over there. So you could talk to him, but this is sort of cybery. In case of fire, I've got to do it. In case of fire, please don't use the elevators. There are stairs next to the lifts. If you need to use the lavatory, if you go out either of these doors into the foyer bit, the lavatories are at either end. It's a bit tricky to get back in, so if you could wait for the breaks, then that would be fantastic. So first of all, I want to thank Adriano and Victor for organizing today. Both have been massively instrumental in making sure that we can set everything up. Adriano represents us as an agency, and Vic works in Dublin and represents a lot of the smaller organizations. And the work that particularly Vic does with all of the clients is critical. And if you have any questions and you're not represented by a specific Google account manager, he's the point that we go to. So if you get a chance to grab him today, he is literally a font of all knowledge and all things Googly. We at Periscopix appreciate your feedback, both on the work that we do in terms of reviews. I'm sure that most of you will know that the seller rating reviews have to be submitted within the last 12 months. So if any of you are inclined today to review Periscopix when you're in a moment of euphoria after the joke of your badge or a session in the photo booth, please do so. But these events are quite a lot of work to organize. You give up your precious time. We're very grateful to Google for hosting the event, and we want to make sure that you get the most out of it. So your feedback from today and your feedback from the last event on mobile was invaluable to shaping today. But if there's anything that you want to know about for next year, please let us know. We want to help try and bring things that we think are relevant to you and your businesses in terms of innovations within the Google interface and bring them to your attention and say, look, it's now time that you take this seriously. But also, we need to be shaped by you. And you need to tell us what you think is important and the kind of stuff that you want to see coming up in the future. During the sessions today, we will be leaving time for questions. We will, at Periscopix, of course, ask some questions to try and get the ball rolling. But please, we're very open. It's all very friendly here. We tried to ingenuate a sort of atmosphere of a little bit more fun with the photo booth. And I want to say a massive thank you to Booth Nation, one of our clients that have provided the photo booth today. If you have a party or an event, they're really good fun. And I'm sure they'd be delighted for you to use them. But please do ask questions. It's important that we keep this as dynamic and social as possible. We are broadcasting this event via a Hangout or a stream through YouTube. So there are people that are watching us, and their questions are also, you know, useful and invaluable. So we're trying to keep it as social as possible. There was some feedback from the mobile event that we weren't necessarily practicing what we preach, so we've tried to take that on board and as socialize this as possible. So do tweet away. Apparently this is going to do something. No? There are people out there watching, I promise. So do ask questions away, and if there's any sort of constructive feedback, please give it. I'd like to introduce Lorenzo, who is one of the product managers for Google+. He links together all of the critical parts within the Google business, and he's the sort of key to making it all successful.
Thanks. Thanks, Tom. Hello, everyone. My name is Lorenzo Bianchi, and I'm a Google Plus product expert. And I'm here today to talk with you about Google Plus, and most importantly, what's our long-term vision? How do we see Google Plus evolving? Before I start with that, just to add on the housekeeping notes, you know, please note the hashtag do work also on Google Plus, so feel free to use hashtags also there. And I don't know, for those of you who have accepted the event that you know, the Periscopix page has sent, if you have you know, a smartphone, you can enable party mode, and every picture that you're gonna take here will be instantly uploaded to the Google event. Great. Before we start, just a quick show of hands. How many of you have a Google Plus profile? Okay, that's good. I would say like roughly 50%. And how many of you use Google products, so have Gmail or, you know, use Maps, Search? Okay, that's, you know, 100%. So there's roughly 40% of you who are actually have not upgraded to Google Plus and are missing out a much richer and most importantly personalized experience that makes everything, you know, more relevant for you. So I thought I'd start with a stat that it's quite impressive, at least to me. And you know, people are intrinsically social. And actually the web, it's making it even easier for us to connect. So easy, in fact, that we are as likely to connect with family and friends through online means as we are face to face. Actually, you know, in UK, based on a research that you know, we've conducted, 89% of the users use online media to connect with their family and friends versus 83 face to face. So as I said, you know, people are intrinsically social before even technology was here. That's a fact. However, today, with the web, we are able to, we have the capability to share things that are important to us at a scale and in a way that was not possible to us even 3 years ago. So consumers don't treat social as something separate from their lives, but they include social into everything they do in their online lives. And we at Google believe that marketers should take the same approach to integrate social into their broader marketing mix. And this is even more important today with social because the lines between paid, owned, and earned media are fading. So we at Google are addressing this shift in consumer behavior through Google Plus, which is really at the heart of our efforts to create a simpler and more intuitive experience for all of our users. But so just to tell you a bit more about my role, a question that you, you know, might have asked or are asking yourself is, why should we take something like this on? Why is Google, what is Google doing in the social media space? Well, our mission, as you can see here, has always been to organize the world's information and make it accessible and useful. This has started 10 plus years ago with our search engine and has grown over time to include a wide range of product that many of you may both use personally and for your marketing initiatives, including Gmail, video, mobile, maps, and so much more. But along the way, we've come to realize that, in fact, not all searches are created equal, and that behind the web of pages and sites that we are organizing, there are people who are actively sharing and connecting with each other. So what's important to me as a sea-loving Italian, it's probably not what's important to you. So this is exactly what we're doing with Google Plus. We are integrating social elements into everything we do at Google to deliver, as I said before, a simpler and a more intuitive, but also most importantly, more personalized and more relevant experience to all of our users. So how we're doing this? We're doing this by adding you know, three things to all of Google. As you know, our CEO and co-founder, Larry, mentioned, Google Plus is Google 2.0. So Google 2.0, how do we get to this 2.0? Basically by adding identity, relationships, and sharing capabilities into every single Google product. We've recently celebrated our 1 year anniversary with Google Plus, and during these first 12 months, we've seen massive momentum growing from a base of zero to 400 million users who have upgraded their account to Google Plus. So that's quite impressive, and I would argue that probably in terms of user growth, Google Plus is the most successful product that Google has ever had. And what this means is that 400 million people have raised their hand and said, hey, I'm Lorenzo Bianchi. And once they log in into Google, they log in into, you know, a wonderful unified experience instead of a series of disconnected products as it used to be. So finally, Google Plus is Google's social layer. And as it is shown in this slide, this is how we think of Google Plus. So not a new and disconnected vertical that adds on top of, you know, our existing products, but rather as a social horizontal dimension that spans across all of Google's product offering. And, you know, later today in this session, you know, Matt is going to come after me. We're going to see how we are adding these social elements into all of these products to, you know, provide a unified and more personalized experience to our users, but also to, you know, allow marketers to integrate social elements into their broader marketing mix. So with that, I'll hand it over to Matt, who's going to talk to you about, you know, more in detail about search and social. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lorenzo. How is everyone today? Feeling good? Yeah? Who's been to a Google presentation at Town Hall before? A few of you. So some of you will know that we like to do some interactive elements, and I'm not going to let you down on this occasion. Can everyone stand up, please? I've had quite a big lunch, chicken curry downstairs today, and we're here to talk about social. So I want us to be social. I want us to feel like we're in one big loving today in the room. So if everyone could look to that wall there, please. Actually turn and face that wall, not just look, turn and face. Put your arms up like you're a zombie. Put your hands on the shoulders of the person in front of you and give them a little massage. Go on, get in there deep. Get in there deep. Does that feel good? Now you can all sit down. These two are still going. Right, who wants to buy Google Plus? I thought my work was done. Okay, so I'm here to talk to you about Google Plus, search and social. There's various things around that we'll touch on as well. Who likes to go on holiday? So this is where my kids have decided we're going in 2016. They went to the Olympics a few times in the summer. We had a lot of fun at the Olympics, and so they've told me that they want to go to Rio in 2016, which, to be honest, sounds like quite a good thing. You know, it's the greatest show on earth. It's better than lying for 3 weeks on a beach in Spain. When they told me this, did I go and look at one of these? So when I was a kid, this was the kind of thing that you used to do. You used to get these brochures from Thomas Cook, and you'd spend ages looking at these things. None of these are actually real. You know, that tennis court wasn't built, and, you know, there were thousands of people around the swimming pool. Now you don't do that. So now when my kids say I want to go to Rio in 2016, I pull out my smartphone, and I start searching, and I start looking for information, and I read blogs, and I read reviews, and I reach out to friends who I know have lived in Brazil or have come from Rio, and I get all this information to make my decisions more intelligent and more relevant to me. And that's the critical thing about Google and Google Plus. That's the critical way in which we're actually trying to change the game in social, and I'll explain more as we go through. There is a lot of choice in the market. These are the social networks that I'm plugged into, which is quite a lot. There's one that I use more than the others. No prizes for guessing which one it is, or which one I'm going to tell you it is today. Anyone want to have a stab at all 12? Anyone? He will, but he's cheating. I'll tell you what, look, who knows this one? This is this. the fancy. The fancy's great. If you're not in the fancy, do get it. You spend a fortune. But the point is, there's lots and lots of choice, and they're all doing something unique. They're all doing something of enormous value. Obviously, what you want to know today is, why is Google Plus any different, and why should you be using Google Plus as a business, but also as a consumer, over and above some of these others? Hopefully, we'll get that today. Now, you know, you'll be familiar with a lot of these quotes. I don't think I'm really telling you anything particularly new. There's one that I'm going to draw. The point here is that, you know, there is this kind of deep-seated need for consumers to connect with their brands in a way that they hadn't done before, and they haven't done before. And I think, you know, this one down the bottom in particular, if there was potential for contact with a real person, that would definitely convince me to add a brand as a friend. It's something I want you to consider as we go through the rest of this presentation. So just to kind of follow on from what Lorenzo was saying, some of the numbers that we're seeing at the moment on Google Plus, 400 million in 12 months, which is a big number. It's a good number. But more importantly, the 30-day stream active. So these are people who are actually going to the Google Plus page at least once a month. And we've got 100 million of those. Now, I don't know if you're up to date with figures of other social networks, but that pretty much puts us number three globally, catching up with the number two. Quite a long way behind the number one, who, you know, I think we'll probably all know who that is. But 12 minutes per day in the stream, that's a big number. That's 12 minutes every single day that people are actually spending in the stream. The other thing, though, that we need to bear in mind is that Google Plus isn't just about the stream. So as Lorenzo was saying earlier, it's Google Plus social. So it's Google. It's adding a social layer to every single one of our products. It's making search better. It's making YouTube better. It's making Gmail better. It's making your phone better, because it's bringing in social signals all of that time. So, you know, if we just consider search, it means that, for the sake of argument, Matthew Geary is going to get a different experience to Mark Woodall every single time they're searching. We're bringing in personalization. We're bringing in social signals. Now, how this might work, to use an example that clearly is quite personal to me. Everyone's heard of Mark Warren? Everyone know who Mark Warren is? Mark Warren, the actor. Mark Warren, the actor, who appeared in Hustle, amongst other things, such slightly cheeky chappy. But there is another Mark Warren that I'm slightly more familiar with. Mark Warren, who's the CEO of Periscopix. So when I search for Mark Warren, yeah, I get information about Mark Warren, the actor, down here. But because Google knows that Mark Warren, CEO of Periscopix, is in my social circles and therefore is a bit closer to me than Mark Warren, the actor, then I automatically get him front and center. So it's taking social signals, taking personal social signals, and adding them into Google to make it a more relevant experience for me. Now, taking this to the next stage, for a brand. So this is a Cadbury search for Cadbury, who are, to be honest, one of the better users of Google Plus. Look at a page for Cadbury when they haven't got a verified Google Plus page. So this is what a search would look like if Cadbury didn't have a verified Google Plus page. Lots and lots of blue links come up for Cadbury. Now, if they turn on their Google Plus page, this is what it looks like. You've got Google Plus post directly in search. You've got the ability to actually click directly through from this into the Google Plus page, and you've got real-time content being dragged directly into this big box. This is completely free. How much would you pay for this size box to appear on the homepage of Google when you consider how much you have to pay for these blue links over here? So this is real-time. So you can see that this was actually during the Olympics. Cadbury's big sponsor of ours, big sponsor of the Olympics. Did a lot of interesting stuff with us, for example, at Hangouts with Rebecca Adlington. Got the user figures up enormously. So they were one of the first brands to break a million followers on their circle, then up to 2.7 million. So, you know, big numbers. And then who's heard of Plus Ones? Has everyone heard of Plus Ones? So Plus Ones is basically someone saying, I like this story, I like this link, I like this brand, I like this product. The critical thing about Plus Ones is that they appear at the point that you're actually searching. So I could, for example, Plus One something a year ago. No one would ever know I Plus One'd it until they actually searched for that particular topic. So the US presidential election is today. It's a really, really good example. It's unlikely you're going to be searching for the US election more than once every 4 years. I don't know a huge amount about American politics, despite having allegedly studied at university. So once every 4 years, I search for the US election. And, you know, there's a number of different media brands, which, to be honest, I'm probably more familiar with, BBC, Telegraph, and so on. But CNN has got 142 people who've actually plus one that page. So there are people out there who are within my social circle who are telling me that CNN is a good place to get this type of information. And when you consider the slightly partisan nature of American politics, it's not a bad thing to have people that I know telling me that this is a good place to get the information. I can trust that particular source. So therefore, I'm more likely to click on that ad, which means that ad quality score is going to go up, which means that the amount they're going to pay to actually show that ad is going to go down. So it's a virtuous circle. Good ads pay less. Here's a slightly more brand-specific example. So here, one of my colleagues, Beth, is searching for a Barcelona hotel. Now, you can see a number of different things that are going on in the search results here. You can see seller ratings, which if you haven't got turned on, you should really turn them on. But here we've got booking.com, 917,000 people following that. It makes sense for me to actually think that's a decent link. Last minute, 381 people. So these are generic and blind plus ones. I don't know who's actually plus one-ing these ads. They're still relevant because there's a volume of people who are actually plus one-ing and saying this is a good link for you to follow. But if you take that to the next stage, let's say for the sake of argument, I actually knew those people. So here, some people that I know personally that are in my social circles, Ade and Nikesh, who's the big boss of Google, if you didn't know, big boss of revenue anyway, and Brad, people in my social circles are actually saying, look, I've booked with lastminute.com, I've booked Barcelona hotels with lastminute.com, this is a good link for you to follow. And so therefore, I'm much more likely to click on that particular link. And the results that we're seeing are incredible. So these are just some of the case studies that we've seen on the improvement in click-through rate for ads that have got social extensions enabled, ads that have got the plus one enabled, from late rooms at 9% to everyday English 46%. We're also starting to do some work about the improvement on conversion as well. So it's some information, I can't give you the brand, but one of my colleagues was telling me this morning, one of the clients he's working with have seen 11% increase in click-through, which has led to a 42% increase in conversion and a 39p drop on CPA. So because there is a plus one, because somebody is saying this is a valuable link, this is something you should be following, it's not only that there are more clicks, but those clicks are of much, much higher value to you than they would have been before. So as a kind of the number one thing that you need to take away from today, that I want you to take away from today, is get your page up and running on Google+, get that page verified, and get plus ones enabled on your site, because you're immediately going to start seeing this impact on your traffic. The other side is on, going back to what Lorenzo was saying about Google+ being this layer across all Google products, another product within the Google stable is YouTube. I'm actually just going to go live for 1 second here if I can. This is my homepage. Now, you know, you can see a number of different things. So this is, how many people have actually got a logged in homepage on YouTube? We're actually getting this personalized content coming through. Really do link your YouTube account with your Google account, because the quality of content that you get through is much, much better. So, you know, what you can see is like a whole host of content that's relevant for me. And at some point, can I just go back to the presentation 1 second? Thank you. So what you can see here is that two pieces of content were shared with me directly on Google+, and are now appearing on my YouTube stream. So, you know, this content has been shared by people in my circles, James Rothwell and Raoul, and they're sharing it on Google+. And so I'm not actually going to Google+ to see this content, I'm going to YouTube. But because they're in my circles on Google+, and the two are connected, I'm actually seeing this content within my YouTube stream. So this engagement is going to get, or this connection is going to get deeper. Can we go back to the so if we just click on if we click on any video, let's click on this one just very quickly. I'm not going to play it. So if I click on the share button, for example, now, you know, one of the reasons why YouTube has always been so successful. Let me turn that off. Is because we've always had Facebook and Twitter integration. So YouTube is the number one most talked brand on Twitter, as an example, and has been for about 3 or 4 years. So we've always had that. We've recently added G+ integration, so essentially you're plus running that ad. We've also got the opportunity or the ability to hang out directly from YouTube. Now, we're going to a bit more detail on Hangouts in a second, but essentially what that's allowing you to do, I'm not going to do it right now, but let's say that you watch this video and you want to watch this with some of your friends and you really, really like this video. You don't have to go anywhere. You can stay right on YouTube. You just press Hangout, and an option will come up to share that Hangout with other people, and then you can actually watch that video directly with the person or people that you've chosen to watch it with. So it's seamless integration of the YouTube and Google Plus products. And this is going to get deeper and deeper and deeper. So any of you who've got video content, you need to start thinking about how you can actually get the maximum exposure for it across YouTube and across across Google, or across YouTube using Google Plus. Back to the presentation, please. So I touched on Hangouts before. Now this is some of my family on firework night, on a bonfire night on Saturday. So every year I have a family bonfire party. We spend a fortune on fireworks. This year we bought the Thriller. I don't know if anyone else did a bonfire night and had the Thriller, but it's basically a minute long finale, which scared the shit out of my cat. But it was a huge amount of fun for the adults. And so every year we do this firework display. But unfortunately this year, a couple of people couldn't come. My sister couldn't come because she's got a 3-week-old baby, which is a nice reason. My dad couldn't come because he's not very well. So essentially, I still wanted them to play a part. I still wanted them to be part of the firework display. So we set up a Hangout. And so a Hangout, for those of you who don't know, is a multiple video sharing platform. So it's like Skype, but on steroids. So you can get 10 people onto a Hangout. So on this occasion, I had three, obviously me and my sister and my dad. And because of the power of mobile technology, I was able to take my Nexus 7 into the garden and show them, and they took part in every part of the firework display alongside the rest of the family. So, you know, a really, really good use of technology, a good way of making sure technology doesn't get in the way, it just adds value to what we're doing. And we are actually showing this on Hangout. Should we show the Hangout as it currently, there we go, there's some people on Hangout. So we've got some people on the Hangout. And some problems with the sound as well. We should probably go back to
that. Hi, guys.
Hello. Right, let's go back. Hello. Who are you?
Neil. Okay. Neil at Periscopix. How are you doing?
Yeah, we're good. How are you?
Good.
Coming through. This is like mission control. It's quite exciting. Okay, we'll come back to you later. Think about some questions that you might have.
Bye.
Okay, good. See ya. Thanks, Neil from Periscopix.
awkward.
We've been talking to various people about doing Hangouts and about the positive impact that they could have from Hangouts. You all know this guy, and in the run up to the State of the Union, Obama was talking to his guys about doing something in social media. He wanted to connect with his users in a slightly different way. His users. He's the people who live in America, his users. I'm just brain chips for Google. So he approached, or his people, not him personally, but his people approached us and said, look, can we do a Hangout? And so we actually got 250,000 people sending in video clips of them asking a question to Barack Obama, and we chose 9 of those people to actually have a live Hangout with Barack Obama, which we actually did as Hangout On Air. So Hangout On Air is when you can actually broadcast it publicly to everyone on your YouTube channel and everyone on your Google Plus page. So whilst 10 people got to participate, 9 plus Barack, it got seen by an audience of millions, and we've got a little clip of what that looked like right now.
Biggest trends is making sure that we're creating fuel-efficient cars.
Mr. President, if it's all right with you, may I just introduce you to my children who are sitting just off camera? Come on over.
Hey, guys!
Just let Nate in, too.
Hey, how's it going?
What do you say?
Make sure to study hard in school and do what your mom tells you.
We'd just like to thank you for giving up a little bit of your time to let us all be a part of this Google interview.
This was great. I really enjoyed it. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Jennifer, remember to send me that information.
I sure will.
See you guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
So, you know, apart from that being just about the coolest experience for those people that you could ever possibly imagine, It is a really, really nice way for people to connect in a different way. So, you know, we all know that face-to-face is better than any other form of communication. It just works. You get to see the person and you get to know a lot more about that person. And so we're talking to a lot of brands at the moment about how they can use the Hangout technology to really advance the way that they're communicating with their customers in a really, really simple way. So we're talking to a couple of DIY shops. For example, tend to most of their traffic during the day is people coming in saying, "I've got this tool and I can't make it work," and they have to come off site, off the building site, to come and do that. So if and all builders have got iPhones because that's the way things are now, and so you know, if they can actually do Hangouts with their customers without that customer having to go to the store, it's much more efficient for the customer and it gives a much better experience for that customer. Much more likely to go back to the brand. And so, you know, there's lots and lots of examples that we're starting to come through, and happy to share some more with you as we chat afterwards. The other thing that we're seeing is this kind of notion of connections. You know, again, using the quite unique nature of a Hangout, the fact that it is face-to-face, it's multiple face-to-face. So John Butterill is a photographer in Canada, and he does these things called photo walks, where essentially he gets a group of photographers together and they go out into the countryside and they take photos of various things in the countryside and they talk about aperture and lighting and whatever photographers talk about. Now obviously there's a few things that you need for that. One, you need to have a camera, you need to be into photography. But the second thing is that you need to have to walk because it's a photo walk. Now there are some people who can't walk. There's a lady who has got multiple sclerosis who hasn't walked for 10 years. She used to be a really, really popular, really, really keen photographer, and she got wind of some of the things that John was doing. In fact, I'm going to stop there and just show the video because I think they can tell the story much better than I can.
One day, I was out taking pictures, and I thought, how cool would it be to attach a phone to your camera and hang out with 5-10 people, and they would see exactly what I was seeing through the viewfinder of my camera. It was amazing. The next day, Corey Fisk came into the Hangout.
I love photography, and I have been living with MS 10 years, and this is my world. There's nothing more to my world than that.
I just said, tomorrow, I'll take you for a walk.
I'm going to walk closer to that old tree over there.
Down a little.
Okay.
A little more, right there. Lovely.
For a few brief minutes, she wasn't going to be in that bed. She was going to experience her own momentary escape.
See you later.
She was on a virtual photo walk. The next day, we posted it. And photographers all over the world jumped on board.
Utah Lake.
Oh, yes, we have a cute girl.
Look at this.
Oh, oh my goodness.
Can you guys see what I'm seeing at the moment?
So this is really, really taken off on Google+. There's a number of different reasons why. I think the first thing is the richness of the stream. So those of you who use Google+ on a regular basis, the ability to do big photos or post big photos and high quality video is absolutely there. The second thing is this kind of notion of the interest graph. So you know, there are other networks who've probably got the social graph more tied up than we ever will. And by social graph, I mean people that you know directly. You already know them. What Google+ has been really good for is demonstrating or introducing people who've got similar interests. And I think you know the one of the best examples of this is photography. So you know, from photo walks, various communities of people have kind of got together through the power of Google+ and have just started taking photos and posting them onto Google+. This actually led to a number of different pages, a number of different videos. They then got together and published their own book, which they called the One Collection. So these are all guys, the Plus One Collection, sorry. So these are all guys who got together as photographers just through the power of Google+, and then released their own hardback book, which was ridiculously expensive, but it's absolutely beautiful. It's stunning. I've got a copy at home. And then to take it to the next level, they actually had a conference where they all got together to talk about photography. Now, these people only met through Google+. They met because they had a shared interest in photography and they loved the fact that the platform can actually connect them in this way. Now, you know, this is one interest group of millions and millions that we've got on Google+. if you were Nikon or Canon or Sony or someone like that, this would be quite a good audience to get to grips with. But there are similar audiences sprouting up all over Google Plus at the moment, where you can actually start to connect with them in a really, really different way. They're engaged with the platform already. If you can add value to that conversation, you've immediately got a much more beneficial, or potentially a much more beneficial relationship with them. And we're also seeing some brands doing some quite cool stuff with Hangouts. So we opened up the Hangout API, which gives you the ability to actually run Hangouts off your own site. And there are various different examples we've seen around games, for example. This is something that we've mocked up for J.Crew, and we'll probably go live quite soon, whereby we're talking about wedding planning. And so wedding planning is something where you want your bridesmaids, I believe, to come along for the dress fitting, but they can't always, especially in America, which is a massive country, and sometimes people come from all over. So what J.Crew want to do is actually have hangouts where essentially you get to kind of go through all the experiences of a wedding dress fitting without actually having to be there. So that's just one example. There's lots and lots of examples that we're starting to see come through, and I think, you know, it's almost the sort of the power of your imagination that will get the best out of the platform. The other thing is about knowing your brand influencers. Who's heard of Ripples? Anyone heard of Ripples? A few people have heard of Ripples. So let me show you Ripples in action. So this is a video. Can we go back? Can we go to the laptop quickly? Thank you. So this is a video for Chris Rock. Has everyone seen this video? Should we just watch a couple of minutes of it? Have we got time to watch a couple of minutes of this? It's very funny. Turn sound up, please. I'm gonna have to skip this video. It's ad.
As you know, the presidential election is on Tuesday. According to the polls, Obama and Romney are still neck and neck. Both campaigns made their final push today. Romney has a very strong lead among white voters, but some prominent Obama supporters are looking to chip into that. And our friend Chris Rock is one of them. Chris Rock is from Brooklyn, here in Brooklyn. And tonight he's recorded a special message for us targeted specifically at undecided voters of the Caucasian variety. So listen and decide for yourself.
Hi, I'm Chris Rock with a special message for white people. In times like these, you need a white president you can trust. And that white president's name is Barack Obama. Let's take a look at the facts. For the first two-thirds of his life, Barack Obama was known as Barry, which is the third whitest name on earth, right after Cody and Jeff. And these are the white people who raised Barry: Madeline and Stanley Dunham. They're so white, they have to wear sunglasses because they're hurting each other's eyes. After college, Barry went into black neighborhoods in Chicago to try to organize people. How white is that? Black people don't go into black communities. We don't have to. We're already there. Look at them, playing golf, body surfing, wearing mom jeans, dancing with Ellen. Barack Obama supports gay marriage. Most black men don't even support straight marriage. President Obama has a dog, but is it a pit bull? Is it a Rottweiler? No, it's a Portuguese water dog. And he named him Bo, after one of the Dukes of Hazzard. And let's not forget, Barack Obama is whiter than Snooki, the tanning mom, and Tara Reid. Even Mitt Romney is blacker than Obama. This is Obama's family. And these are the Romneys. Look at that. Kids, cousins, aunts, uncles. Mitt Romney's family has more people in it than a Tyler Perry movie. And if you're still not convinced, check this out.
I, Barack Hussein Obama, do solemnly swear.
I am a white guy.
So help me God.
If you want a white president, I've got a polo-wearing, Hawaii-living, home beer-brewing, league bowling guy for you. Barry Obama, he's just white.
Okay, so absolutely no reason to show that video apart from the fact it's very funny. What I wanted to show you, which is actually a bit more relevant to what we're talking about today, it's a great piece of content, obviously. What you can do with any content that you post on Google+ is you can see how it's shared. So straight away, you can start to see who are the key influencers in your brand. So on this particular occasion, you can see that Casey McKinnon, when she shared this particular piece of content, it went absolutely crazy. When Guy Kawasaki, which is where actually I got it from, shared it, we saw another circle coming together. It's now gone to Germany, so Spiegel Online have posted it today. They're getting multiple reshares as well. And what you can actually do is watch the spread of the post. If you click on this here, you can actually see the post spreading. And you can go into each and every one of these and see when it stops that. You can go in and see exactly what they said about it. And so you start to get a picture of, you know, who's really influencing your brand. Now, if this is like if this is a brand piece of content, then it would make sense to try and get. Oh, hang on a minute, didn't mean to do that. To try and get much closer to people like Casey McKinnon, because you know that if she shares a piece of content that you've put up, it's likely it's going to get multiple reshares. It's going to get seen by a much, much, much wider audience. So, really, really kind of simple way of actually trying to understand exactly who your brand influencers are. Can we go back to the presentation, please? And so, you know, the four key things that we say are most important around Google+, discoverability, standing out in search, the sharing of content, the fact that we've got this integration with YouTube, the engagement, so Hangouts On Air in particular, but personalizing the conversation. Marketing performance. I think, you know, for the first time, we were actually in a position where we can really, really determine the performance value of social media through the benefit of plus ones. And measurability. So we've already got the search click-through uplift, but we've got social insights coming to Google Analytics very, very soon. And when that happens, we're going to see a whole raft of new data coming through. So finally, 10 things for brands to do today with Google+. There are only three things that we need to focus on today. And that's in the green basic area. We can do all of these things later, but the three most important things: creating a Google+ page to establish that brand identity, and get it verified, obviously. Enable social extensions to improve search performance. So the average is 5 to 10%, and that's for blind. So where you can't actually see the users who are plus one in your ad, we're seeing about 5 to 10%. As I said before, you know, for brands who are testing this right now, we're seeing figures far in advance of that. And then add the Google+ page to generate awareness and increase followers. So by adding the Google+ page to your site, you're going to see an increase of followers by somewhere around 38%. So do those three things as soon as you get back to the office today. It doesn't cost a penny. And you'll start to see that massive increase in click-through that we talked about earlier. That's it for me. We have got a bit of time for questions, I believe, if anyone's got any questions. Yes. Have we got a microphone? Sorry.
So I have set up a Google+ page for the company that I work for, Clarinet.
Yeah.
And we've put the badge on the website, and we've followed the instructions to verify the page, but we still don't have the tick beside. It doesn't appear to be verified, even though we have.
Okay. I'm going to actually pass that to Lorenzo. Lorenzo, can you answer that question?
Yeah, that's actually very easy. So if you connect with your CSR and ask them, there is an internal form that they have to submit, and then 72 hours will verify that.
We don't have that.
Okay. So
just pass it on to the Periscopix guys. We'll get that done for you.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Any other questions?
We have a Google+ page, but it is set up for our US corporate site.
Mm-hmm.
Do we need one for the UK site if it is a separate site, or can we link it to the same Google+ page?
So again, I'm going to pass that back to Lorenzo. Lorenzo, you just want to come up?
Yeah.
Can we turn Lorenzo's mic on?
Okay, so here, there are multiple ways of dealing with this, right? We've seen brands that have a main global corporate page, such as Uniqlo, for example, and they manage, you know, different languages and countries with the circle functionality. However, that today is not yet at an optimal stage because it's still manual, but, you know, product is working on that, and, you know, hopefully soon we'll be able to, you know, use circles in a easier way. Or we've seen, on the other hand, brands that are basically just creating multiple pages for each market they are in. So in travel clients, for example, they have, you know, deals that are relevant just to one market or one country. So they are basically replicating their strategy or structure that they have on their websites. So every domain has their own plus page. And that's actually working very well for them to, you know, manage this page differently. So it really depends ultimately on, A, how much resource you have to do that, and B, how important to you it is the country language barrier.
Sorry, it's not really an issue of language because it's the US and the UK, so it's the same language. But we find that the recent Google updates have affected our search position for the .co.uk. And I'm thinking, is it because, you know, we're only being found as a .com rather than a .co.uk because of the...
So I don't want to go too technical here, but you have actually right now the ability of linking more than one domain to a same plus page.
Okay.
So that could be for probably the best option for you. So also link the .co.uk domain to the .com plus page. And so doesn't matter if they search one or the other, they will still see the same, you know, plus one number showing in the social annotation.
Okay, thank you.
Again, you know, if we get the request, we have an internal tool to do it very quickly. So I guess same thing as before, you know, through Periscopix, let us know, and we'll do that. Yeah.
Any other questions?
One here.
Yeah, Max from Travel Stay Network. As users are logging in and using Google+, it seems from our analytics that we can't see the keywords that they're using to come across our site. How are we going to get some insight into how Google+ users are coming across our site if they're not linked into our own Google+, but just logging in?
Yeah, that's a very good
go.
And, you know, as Matt was mentioning before, working on social insights, which is actually gonna, you know, give you a lot of that, and it's gonna also allow you to understand, actually, you know, more about the content you are posting and how that's performing. So hopefully, a lot of that will be, you know, addressed with social insight that should launch by the end of this quarter, and it will be a native tool that's going to be hosted in the Google Plus. You know, the plus.google.com domain. So for all every page owner, they would have, you know, an inside option. But yeah, to go back to your question, today is not currently possible to measure that.
Other questions? One more. This last one.
Just a quick one. Just wondering if you're planning to expand Hangouts at all so that you can use it with more than 10 people for things like webinars and broader communications.
I think, you know, the power of Hangout is obvious and therefore to see. We have seen examples already, and so we've been testing already in the US internally Hangouts of much larger than 10 people. Now, obviously, you know, there are bandwidth issues, as I'm sure you can imagine, and we want to make sure they're controlled. There is a feeling that around 10 is the right number at the moment in terms of having people actually on the Hangout. What you can also do is a Hangout on Air, where you can actually broadcast to everyone. Actually, for that fireworks example I showed you earlier that I did on Saturday, I set up a Hangout on Air. It takes 20 seconds at most. It's really, really straightforward. You just need to verify your YouTube page to your Google account. And once you've done that, you can broadcast anytime you like to get maximum exposure.
Are we doing that? We're doing that today, by the way. We're live streaming this event on YouTube. So if you go to YouTube, the Periscopix channel on YouTube, you will see everything that's happening right here.
You can watch the whole event again on YouTube. How about that?
There are people watching it now.
As well as on the stream of Periscopix in the plus.
Okay, brilliant. Look, thank you very much. I'm now going to pass over to Glenn, who is our GDN expert, and he's going to talk you through GDN and the power of social in the display network. Thank you.
Matt Bush, everyone. Okay, cool. So I'm going to start off, if I can put my water there, that'd be good. I'm going to start off by telling you a story. Recently, it was my sister's 25th birthday, which means I was kind of legally obligated to buy her a gift. Now, as with most guys, I'm notoriously bad at buying gifts for women. I looked at the main things I could possibly buy her. So the first thing was flowers. I thought her boyfriend will probably cover that, or hopefully. She likes candles, but she's got a ton of them. How many do you honestly need? I've got one in case there's a blackout. So I wasn't going to buy her candles. And then I've got nowhere to start with jewelry. So like a lot of my research online, it started with a search. So the search is pretty self-explanatory. The search was, those of you who aren't hawk-eyed, gift ideas for my sister's 25th birthday. Now, there were nearly 3 million results. So I started to feel a bit more confident that I might actually find something that she might like. Now, out of all these results, you can see the one I clicked on that's highlighted here. The title was Best Birthday Gift for My Sister's 25th Birthday. So I thought, jackpot, this is it. Clicked on the site. The answer from Wiki Answers wasn't actually what I thought would be good. A couple of people read it already, but for everyone else, I think a best gift for sister is your love. Now, I'm not sure how many people in the room have had a birthday, but you cannot go to a birthday armed just with your love. Believe me, I have tried. But while I was on this site, I noticed an ad that kind of jumped out at me. Some of you may be thinking it was the Osaka return flight for £601. If I bought my sister a flight, it would be a one-way trip to Osaka. No, actually, this is the ad that I looked at. And you can see, as we've been talking about, it had a social annotation. It's the Urban Outfitters new collection sale. Now, two of the people that have plus won this were two people that I'm connected with, along with 766 more people. And they're pretty stylish people, so I thought, maybe if they like Urban Outfitters, then maybe my sister might as well. So I went to the Urban Outfitters site, and I thought, maybe I could go with vouchers, but it's pretty, you know, tame. I wanted to be a bit braver than that. So I decided, as it was getting really cold, as it's cold now, I'd buy her a jacket. And this is the jacket I chose, and I'll tell you the reasons for it. One, my sister wears too much black, so it's not a black jacket. It might be a bad decision. We'll find out shortly. Secondly, the model in this example has the same colorings as my sister. But to point out now to everyone, my sister's not a model. But yeah, she looks kind of similar to this. The third reason, and this was the clincher for me, is that the model in this example isn't smiling. And that reminded me the most of my sister. So I just wanted to have a bit of feedback from you guys now. All the ladies in the room, in a moment, I'm going to ask if you would wear this item, if you think this is a good piece of clothing, a good gift idea, and you would actually wear this item, please raise your hand. Okay, you. You raised your hand first, lady. What's your name, please? Victoria. Victoria, don't worry, it's nothing bad. As a memento of today, I'm actually going to buy you this jacket from Google. So round of applause, everyone. Victoria, for having such great style.
Thank you.
Giving you a bit of content. So give your details to Adriano, and the gift will wing its way to you. So congratulations. Unfortunately, I'm not here just to talk about or to give away jackets. I'm actually here to talk about three products on the Google Display Network that will hopefully bring you more conversions. Now, everyone's familiar with search. So search is brilliant. Quick recap on search. You choose your keywords. Someone searches your keyword. They go to your site, and hopefully they buy your product. Now, search is great, but people are only searching online 5% of the time. The rest of the time, they're doing everything else on the network. So what happens when the moment of relevance happens, when you decide that you're not just going to buy a gift, but you're actually going to buy a coat or a jacket for your sister, happens when you're not searching? Well, now you can use the same search keywords on the Google Display Network. So before, it was all thematically based. You had to use lots of different keywords in the same ad group. You didn't know what keywords were powering what you were appearing against. Now our technology is a lot stronger. You can use individual keywords to target the display network. And we know that relevancy matters. So there's a couple of stats here that I'll just quickly go through. So the first is that people fixate on contextually ads 15% more often than unrelevant ads. And they also elicit an emotional response twice as high as something that's not relevant to the content you're looking at. So the example here is an editorial I just made of a camera review site. So the keywords you could be, you know, appearing against are cameras, capture, et cetera, et cetera. And the type of camera that it is appearing against is a top 5 SLR. And here's an ad right next to it. So if anyone was looking at an editorial, they're probably in market for that product. And what a great place to place the ad. So just a recap of what's happened. You can now place keywords, and they target more accurately. So year on year, there's a 30% increase of targeting keywords to the content that they actually appear against. There's more control, so you can fine-tune your performance. You can actually do it at a keyword level, so that's not just what keywords you're appearing against. It's also your keyword level bids. And then you can also see what placements you're appearing against, down to every impression. So if something's working, you can obviously do more of it. If something's not working, you can decrease it until it is working, or even get rid of it. And then it's very efficient. So a lot of our customers at Google are doing search. But you can just take your search campaigns, basically. There are a few best practices. But you can copy and paste them over into another campaign, and you can start running on the Google Display Network almost immediately. So that what's happened there is now someone's looking at a content that you're using a keyword on. They go to your site, and hopefully they go on to convert. Now, if you find you are getting conversions, what you can obviously do is maximize that. You can add extra keywords. You can increase your bids. But what would be better if you had a tool that did that, all of that for you? It basically automated everything you would do anyway, but did it so, you know, wasn't a manual process. And this is what we've launched very recently. So I think it was as few as 3 months ago, we launched the Google Display or the Google Campaign Optimiser tool. Now, what this does, and I'll just go through this very quickly, it learns what you're doing. So it sees where you're getting conversions online. Once you've got 15 conversions in one campaign or at a URL level, it basically can learn and target similar keywords, similar placements that you're not already targeting, and add them to your campaign. It optimizes this at a target CPA that you set. So if you can only afford £15 per a conversion, that's what it will optimize to. And then it will expand that. So it will keep adding placements. It will keep finding keywords. And if keywords change in terms of how well they're working, it will optimize to that as well. What we've seen is there's a 24% uplift in volumes from when someone turns it on to 2 weeks later. And that's only touching two buttons. So that's not having to touch it manually. you just let it go, you let it learn, and you'll see, on average, a 24% uplift. One of the advertisers I was working with was giving away free sims. Now, they could only afford to give free sims out at a certain cost, which is around £10, because not every free sim that was ordered was activated. So I was optimizing this campaign for about 6 months, and I've got it to spend on a display network about $4,000 a day. And then I tried this out, and this tool, when I recently went back and looked at the campaign, was spending $11,000 a day. So it was spending the $4,000 it was, plus the extra that Display Campaign Optimizer was doing, the extra $7,000, and it was all cost effective. It was all at target CPA. So I think this is the most powerful tool we have in terms of when people are looking at content online. You don't know who that user is, you just know what they're looking against. So you've gone from choosing your own keywords to optimizing it, then automating everything you're doing. But what about when it's not that simple? So what about when you have a product that no one ever converts first time on? Well, for that, we have remarketing. So hands up, everyone who's familiar with remarketing, just a quick show of hands. So get some separation between the arms. Good, good. So most of you in the room, for everyone else, you drive people to your site. They don't convert, unfortunately. So you cookie them when they land on the page. And then because they've not converted, you remarket to them across the web, and they come back to your site and they convert. Now, I don't really have to pitch it to you too much, because I went to your site in preparation to this event, and I was on YouTube having a YouTube break, as I often do, and I saw a Periscopix ad remarketed to me as I was watching the video, which I thought was very nice. Good job. So some stats just on remarket, just to recap why we think this is very important. We think 97% of people don't convert on their first site visit. So whatever it is you're looking to do, whether that's a sign up or is actually a sale, et cetera, only 3% of people that come to your site usually do that on a first site visit. And 72% of people that have a basket page will drop off and not actually convert. And one of the major reasons that people do that is they're actually saving those products for later. So they may not be in the mood, they may be just being in a research phase. But if you can drive people back to your site, then hopefully you can incentivize them to buy in some way. Now, how these two tools fit together, and we've got an example of this with a finance comparison site. So someone where you come and you compare things like credit cards, mortgages, current accounts. They know how much someone, a new user, is worth to them. So what they do is they put a pixel or a conversion tag on their site. They drive new users cost effectively and scale that, because they know once someone's been to their site, that person then has a value, and then they remarket to that person and they actually drive cost effective marketing using those two products together. Something I wanted to talk to you about today is our remarketing product has become more sophisticated very recently. We've launched two products. One is Google Analytics remarketing, where you can convert your existing Google Analytics tags and convert them just by changing a small piece of code to a remarketing tag, and they'll appear in your AdWords interface, and then you can use the people will then start being cookied just on the site straight away, and then you can start converting to them. We've also got a new pixel, which is called New Pixel. I don't know how long it's going to be called New Pixel, unfortunately. Maybe until the next iteration of it. But you basically place the same tag on every single page of your site. And what that allows you to do is, within the AdWords interface, basically create rule-based lists. So rather than having to have five tags to do different things, for example, one tag saying, I want to keep someone on a tag for 5 days, one for 7 days, 30 days, because people may interact differently. You just need one tag. Then from that one tag, you can actually create those five rules so it doesn't bog down your page. And then on top of that, you can start collecting what we call custom parameters from your site. So this is when you start collecting what people have looked at in your page. So maybe the basket value. So I'm guessing someone that has or is looking at a product that has a value of £200 is probably worth more to you than someone that's looking at a value of, say, £10. You can also look using at Google Analytics at how long someone's been on your page. So someone that's been on your page for a couple of seconds probably isn't worth as much to you as someone that's been on your site for a couple of minutes. You can also look at the type of products that people have looked at while they've been on your site. So then you can not just remarket them with a generic ad, but obviously with the products that they've looked at to make a more compelling message for them to come back. So when they come back to your site, you know, they're more incentivized to click on that ad, they're more incentivized to convert. But now, this is kind of the biggest and most recent announcement of, or the most recent launch. So it deserves a sip of water. You can now do remarketing, not just on the Google Display Network, but also when people are searching. Why this is important is that people do multiple searches per purchase. So for car insurance, we see an average of 3 searches for every car insurance purchase. So people may be using comparison sites. They go, they obviously do the searches, go to sites, and convert after 3 searches. Travel, people seem to care about more, maybe because they've got a limited amount of holiday, or maybe just one holiday, a big holiday a year, hopefully, at least. But there are 20 searches on average for travel. So there's lots of times when someone's been to your site where you can interact differently with that person compared to someone who's been to your site or never been before and you just searches for your terms. So there are 3 kind of ideas I've come up with today that I just wanted to go through. The first is a repeat customer. So if we take the clothing idea again, if you've got a clothing site and someone bought something from you there and they're searching for something else that you've got, another product, you may want to appear higher in the search results than you would for anyone who searches for that product. Say it was a generic search, such as, say, jeans. You maybe couldn't afford to be number one in the search results for every single search. However, if someone's already been to your site and has already, say, converted from you, or maybe they've just been to your homepage, you'd probably want to bid more aggressively and be in a higher position than someone that, you know, that you didn't know anything about. The second example is for something where it's for new customers only. So let's, as an example, think of a broadband provider. So people are using paperless billing, so they check their bills in their account. So they often do brand searches. If someone's checking their bills, you can cookie that user. So when they search for your brand terms, they don't click on your new customer acquisition ads because you don't have one appearing. You could even choose to have a customer service ad there instead, because you know that person's already a customer. You want to drive them away from, say, a call center, for example, if they've got an issue. The third one is tailoring search creative. So let's use the travel example again. If someone's done a search for you previously and has looked at a certain destination and then searches for a travel search again, maybe every single other result is just a generic ad, but because you know they've searched for an Egypt holiday and have been on that page for a certain amount of time, so they're very keen and very interested, maybe they've been there multiple times, you can lead with a message about Egypt holidays, and if you've got the technology, maybe offer them an incentive to purchase that holiday now. So I think basically using remarketing lists for search ads, if you're not doing it, you're not doing it as effectively as you possibly could. So this is one of the biggest launches, is I think, that's happened in search for a couple of years. So I'd encourage you to speak to your Google representative about getting you whitelisted for this very new beta. And now, how this all fits together, well, you've got your user at the top here. The black line, first he goes down to a site, maybe he comes from another way of coming to a site. He may or may not go on to convert. If he doesn't convert, you can now remarket to that user using search remarketing when he's searching, And for the 95% of the time he's not searching, you can do a or remarket to that user across the Google Display network. Now, also you can use insights. You can look at the type of people that convert on your site. You can use the profile of your customers, say, are they mainly male or female? Are they mainly interested in sports, or are they mainly interested in TV or film? And you can use those insights to maybe power the type of display queries that you're looking at to drive new customer acquisition along with your search targeting. So that's how I kind of see this all kind of fitting together. So thank you for indulging me. I think we've got time for questions now, but those are three basic tools I wanted to go into to introduce to you the Google Display Network. Thank you very much. Any question? One question over here.
Hi there. I just wanted to know, so this search functionality for remarketing, when's that going to be fully released as a full release to everyone?
At the moment, it's difficult to give a turnaround time. We've been told, you know, we're hoping to work on it a lot this quarter. We're hoping to launch it as soon as as next year. That's the timeline we've got at the moment. But at the moment, it's just in the testing phase. We're encouraging advertisers to still get involved. So do get involved. But I haven't got a turnaround time I can give you.
Sure. And would you still use the sort of same tags, or would you require updates of tags or anything?
No, it's basically the same tag-based lists that you'd currently use for remarketing tag-based lists. So this, if you've got remarketing set up already, most people have it on the home page, their product pages, their basket page, their conversion page. A lot of people have just done remarketing for search on people that have done or have been to their homepage and then just seen the results. We've seen fantastic results in terms of click-through rates, conversion rates, and return on ad spend just from people having one tag on their homepage. But hopefully we're going to evolve this tag so it will be the new pixel that I talked about, and then it will be just one tag to do all of these different things. Cool, thank you. Got a couple of questions.
Hi, I'm Naomi from Marie Curie Cancer Care. I just wondered if you've seen a big impact on remarketing since the cookie law came in.
Yeah, interesting question. Thank you for asking. it's not basically the rule came in to force a year before everyone started thinking about it because there was delay on the rule. No one kind of knows what is compliant in terms of cookie law and what isn't. All we can do is encourage advertisers to, and even just websites that use cookies, just to be as clear as possible on their site about the fact they are collecting cookies and how they're using cookies. Unfortunately, there's no body at the moment that is able to say this is compliant, this is not. And everyone really panicked about it. I know on a couple of people I know just removed cookies off their website straight away, but we've not seen any major impact from it. And so we'll continue watching this space. My personal view, if I'm allowed to say that, is there's kind of a disconnect between, you know, the view of cookies just to the public and people in the industry, and it's more of an education piece about what cookies are used for and why you need them to use websites, because in many cases you have to have them for websites to even work.
Excuse me. We have an issue with counterfeit websites that copy our brands. Periscopix do a great job taking them down. What more can we do together to remove counterfeit goods in the top page of search?
Interesting question. And being a display network specialist, it's a tough one for me to answer. I know, Adriano, if you've got any viewpoints on what we're doing. We're always investing in technologies to stop that from happening. There's always going to be kind of loopholes and ways around it, and we always, are trying to evolve our technologies to prevent that from happening. But as soon as you notice those, do flag them. We're hoping that our tools are getting quicker and quicker at responding to hopefully get these people taken down.
Thanks. Yeah, Max from Travel Stay Network. Just to understand search remarketing a little bit better, if someone searches for a term, comes across the site, and we want to re-advertise to them, rather than paying for the same click for the same original ad, we'd be able to position our ad on our cost per click differently on a search remarketing basis?
Yes, so exactly that. So you basically would have, you used to have very basically in search two campaigns, your brand terms and your generic terms. I mean, obviously then you'd have your top performance, but very basically, let's say there's two types. Now I think there's gonna be four basic campaigns. So you're gonna have your brand and your generic, but then you're gonna have your, you know, your people that have been to your site before, so your premium non-branded searches and your premium branded searches. So these are people that have been to your site before. So all you're going to do is you're going to take the same keywords, and if you want to, if you think they're worth more to you because they've been to your site, you're going to bid up more for those people, and you're going to change the messaging based on what they've looked at. Conversely, for people that are, you know, doing brand searches, if you don't want to show a brand term, then you just use those lists as a negative, and you don't appear on those terms for those people.
So in terms of non-branded search terms, if the average user goes to a travel website, for example, about searches for about 20 different travel websites, then potentially all 20 travel websites could be re-advertising for those search terms at a slightly higher cost?
Potentially, if that person's been to 20 different sites and they're all doing the same technology, then they will, obviously it's up to them. If they are doing this, they can interact differently for that advertiser.
Okay. All right, thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Any more for any more? Oh.
One question very quickly. Could you just talk us through how the you talked about the Google Analytics tag and using that for remarketing or converting that tag for remarketing. Could you just talk through a little bit more about how that works?
Yeah, so are you using Google Analytics already?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, cool. So for Google Analytics to work, you have to have a Google Analytics code on the HTML of your website or a container tag, if you've got a container tag. All you have to do is just swap the tag. It's just one line of code from one to another. And then if you've got your Analytics and AdWords accounts linked together, hopefully you have already, you can do that just within Analytics. It takes 2 seconds, two minutes, let's be more honest about how that takes. And then once you're linked together, you just basically can start producing remarketing lists in Google Analytics. And then when you refresh your AdWords pages, you'll start seeing those AdWords remarketing lists within your AdWords accounts. Then you just can just link them to your existing campaigns, and you can remarket as you would with the new tag. So for a lot of our advertisers that are using Google Analytics, it's just a quick way to get tags on their site, but it comes with extra things that you know, other tags haven't been able to do before, like bounce rates, for example. If someone's been to your site multiple times, you can perhaps you've got that information. You've even got where that person came from in terms of what site they came from. So it may be that people that are coming from certain sites or certain pathways are worth more to you than others. Cool. One in the middle, Adriano.
Adriano. On the search term remarketing, excuse me, obviously we can set a different bid. Can we write a separate advert?
Yes.
Completely separate. So we'll only show the second or the third time that they've come across it.
Yes. Yeah, so you basically, whatever list they fall under, you just have your search term. You say, if they're in this list, I want to show them this ad. Then you'd have another group saying, if they've been twice, if it is your example, if they've been there once, I show them this ad. If they've been there twice, I show them this ad. And you can tailor their ad creative based on how many times they've been to the site or even just what they've looked at, whatever you've cookied up and you've chosen to show the ad for.
Cheers.
Anyone else?
I think that's it. Thank you very much. Thank you for your questions and your time. Thank you very much.
We're going to take a short break now. Then we're going to come back and we're going to hear from Alistair and Ben. Please help yourself to refreshments and do get involved in the photo booth. It just sits there empty. It looks very sad.